Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to First Presbyterian Church of Winnicottie on this beautiful day. I hope it stays as nice as it was yesterday. Get a little more yard work done. We're glad to have you with us today in person or watching our video from afar. Our church's mission is to share God's love and shine God's light. And we hope you feel the love and the light of God as we worship together today. I'm Annie Leonard, and today we're pleased to have Gina Strinzi with us to lead us in worship. I have a couple of announcements to share this morning. If you have an offering, you may place it in the basket in the back as you leave today. And please join us after church for refreshments and conversation in Fellowship Hall. The Mosley family is going to be providing that for us. Are there any additional announcements? John?
I bring you great tidings of joy. Thanks to the initiative of Christina Mosley, we got together and we are going to have choir. Christmas Eve will be our first performance. We'll see what happens after that. But there is a bit of a caveat. We need to be vaccinated. All choir members need to be vaccinated, and we will be wearing masks. Christina has also offered anybody who would rather have one of those plastic, whatever they're called, excuse me, that's also in their works if you need it. And the first practice will start 6:45 on the 8th of December. So the 8th, the 15th, the 22nd, and then, of course, Christmas Eve, the 24th. There you have it.
Those are glad tidings. I think we need those face shields so they can see us smile while we sing. Warms my heart. Any other joys or concerns to lift up this morning? Pat?
My son-in-law had surgery. Yeah, I understand that he got home.
And what's his first name, Pat?
Todd.
Todd. Thank you. I think we're good on those. Let us bring ourselves before the Creator and join together in the call to worship. Grace to you and peace from the one who is and who was and who is to come.
And from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts.
The whole earth is full of God's glory.
Holy, holy, holy,
and frees us from our sins. Therefore, let us confess our sins to God. Please take a moment of silence to bring yourself before our Creator. Let us join together in the prayer of confession. Holy One, we dare to call you Lord, but to yield to you only fragments of our lives. You have nowhere to lay your head. We surround ourselves with comfort. We expect to serve you with what remains after we have indulged our desires. Forgive our greed, our lack of trust, our desire to pick the times and places we will respond to our call. In your abundant mercy, teach us what it means to follow, even at the cost of our lives.
Amen.
The mercy of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting. I declare to you in the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Amen. The love of peace with one another as you are most comfortable.
Today's offering has to do with a shortcoming of my own, big time. It's called patience. And we've all endured a great deal through this last year and three quarters, whatever it is. Anyway, patience. Something to reflect on, I guess.
Thank you, John. Please join me in the unison offertory prayer. Sisters and brothers, we worship the one who stands at the beginning and at the end of history, the God for whom all time is now. Every day we have a chance to participate in the work God is doing in the world by bringing our gifts each week. By offering our lives each day, we affirm our trust in a power beyond violence, beyond greed. Let us gladly offer who we are and what we hold in service to God. Amen. Servants of your hidden holy reign. We pray in the name of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Amen. Our first reading today comes from John 18, verses 33 through 37, in preparation for today's message. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." That ends the first reading.
Our second reading today is from the book of Revelation. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty, the King of Kings. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
So what do you think of when you hear the phrase King of Kings? That's what I think of. That's what runs through my mind. Now that would be stuck in your minds all day. But seriously, what do you think of when you hear the phrase King of Kings?
Jesus.
Jesus. Jesus is the answer to everything. So does anyone else do like I do and start singing the Hallelujah Chorus in their head? Yeah, me too.
There is no other answer to that question.
Oh, there is no other answer to that question, says Annie. Why did Jesus get this title? He wasn't a king in the traditional sense. Kings ride into battle on horses. And Jesus rode into Jerusalem on a
donkey.
Oh, you guys are good. That is hardly a ride fit for a king. I like the connection between these two passages we just read. In John's Gospel, Pilate accuses Jesus of being king of the Jews. And in Revelation, God refers to himself as the King of Kings. Did you ever wonder how or why certain scripture readings are paired with each other?
Yeah.
Anyone ever wonder that? I see a head nod. I hear a yeah. Who gets to decide what we read in worship each Sunday? Maybe we just open the Bible, close our eyes, and place a finger on a page, and that is what was read. Does anyone think that's how it works?
Lottery.
There's actually a lot more to it than that. We follow something called a lectionary. The Revised Common Lectionary is an ecumenical 3-year cycle, A, B, and C, of scripture readings used in many churches in many denominations. There are typically four scripture readings chosen for each Sunday. One from the Old Testament, a psalm, an epistle or letter, and a gospel reading. Some churches read all four readings every Sunday. Has that ever been a tradition here?
No.
You guys answer really quickly. So maybe it hasn't been. Do you think we should try that one Sunday?
Oh, no.
Ooh, some strong feelings about that. I respect that, and that is perfectly okay. Today happens to be the last Sunday of lectionary year B. Year B tells us that most of the gospel readings this year come from Mark's gospel. Year A is for Matthew. Year B is for Mark. Any guesses as to who gets year C?
Luke.
Luke. You guys are so smart. Thank you. I could not have timed that any better. But what about John? There is not a year D. So John's gospel gets mixed into years A through C, especially around the major liturgical holidays. Advent, Easter, Lent is where you will find John's gospel. The lectionary is supposed to help pastors avoid preaching on only their favorite scripture passages and books of the Bible. Can you imagine only ever hearing sermons from the book of Leviticus? That was kind of my thought too. Or Numbers? By the way, not all churches follow the lectionary. If we here at First Presbyterian in Winneconne didn't follow the lectionary, until recently, I would never have chosen to preach on the book of Revelation. That book scares me. At least it used to. One of my seminary classes this semester is an entire class on the book of, guess what, Revelation. And because just reading the book in English would be way too easy, instead we are reading Revelation in its original language of Koine Greek. This class has opened my eyes to the once scary book and enlightened me that this book contains more than just an end-of-the-world prediction. In my opinion, it doesn't actually do that at all. But that's a topic for another time. Along with today being the first Sunday of gun deer hunting season, and the last Sunday in lectionary year B, it is also a special Sunday in the church year. Does anyone know what this Sunday is? Christ the King, or sometimes it's referred to Reign of Christ. On this day, we celebrate and give thanks for the power and authority of Christ, who will triumph over evil. Christ the King Day was established in 1925 by Pope Pius XI. The Pope believed that Christians were being lured away from the church by the increase of secularism in the world. He also saw Christians choosing to live in the kingdom of the world rather than the kingdom of God. Christ the King is the final Sunday in the liturgical year and delivers us just to the brink of Advent. Next Sunday is the first Sunday of Advent and the beginning of lectionary year C. We move from our Lord as King to our Lord as a tiny baby in a manger surrounded by multitudes of angels. But for now, let's take a look at our King of Kings. Today, we read two stories about Jesus as King. In the first story from John's Gospel, we find Jesus, who was arrested just a short time ago, now taken to the Roman governor's palace. The story begins with Pilate asking Jesus, Are you the King of the Jews? If Jesus claimed the title of King, he would be put to death. Instead, Jesus says, "My kingdom is not from this world." In our second King of Kings story, we read the opening greeting of a letter from the book of Revelation. This salutation introduces the seven letters John wrote to seven different churches in Asia Minor, or as we know today, modern-day Turkey. John was a Jewish Christian who most likely was a leader of these seven churches, possibly even their pastor. He was exiled to the island of Patmos for being a Christian and proclaiming the gospel. Can anyone imagine being exiled just for being a Christian and proclaiming the gospel? I think we'd all be on the island if that were the case. These letters were written during a time of intense persecution of Christians under Emperor Domitian. During Domitian's rule, the Greeks were the first-class citizens. The Jews were a very low, second-class citizen. And at the bottom, we find the Christians. The worst of the worst in the eyes of Rome. They didn't bow down and worship the emperor, and they talked different and acted different. The Romans could not understand these people who chose to worship the King of Kings, the one true God over and above the emperor. In today's scripture reading, we hear an echo of one of my favorite Bible verses. The exact version I prefer is found later in the book of Revelation and reads, "I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end." Fun fact, this verse is one of only two times in the book of Revelation where God speaks directly to us. This verse brings me comfort. God is with us in the beginning, before we are even born. And Christ promises to be with us at the very end, when God's kingdom reigns. Jesus tells Pilate, "My kingdom is not of this world." Many have interpreted this to mean that Jesus' kingdom is somewhere in heaven and not relevant to this world. To me, Jesus is saying that the values of his kingdom are different from those of this world. I think we are called to realize God's kingdom here on earth as well as in heaven. What do you think God's kingdom looks like? What do you think God's kingdom on earth looks like?
Winnicani.
It's in a bit of disarray. Winnicani. Interesting contrast. Any other thoughts as to what God's kingdom on earth looks like?
It's the church.
This week on the news, I listened to the story of a high school basketball team in California. I'm sorry, basketball. It says football, high school football team in California. This football team, for the first time ever, went undefeated through their regular season. Friday night, they won their semifinals playoff game, and now they are on their way to the championship. The entire football team and their coaches are deaf. The teams they play against are not. This is the first and only time in the school's 68-year history that any sports team has made it to the semifinals. Maybe that is a sign of the kingdom of God here on earth. I'd like to share with you a video of how I envision the kingdom of God.
Ooh, ooh, ooh. just too little love. What the world needs now is love, sweet love. No, not just for some, but for everyone. Ooh, ooh, ooh. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There's mountains and hillsides enough to climb. There are oceans and rivers enough to cross, enough to last until the end.
Christ the King Sunday beckons us to give glory and praise to our King and King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We serve a King like no other, a King who is not seeking fame and fortune, but instead is longing for us to serve and love the Lord and one another. How will you bring love into the world this week to build up the kingdom of God? Let us pray. Almighty God, you have exalted Jesus over all creation to lead us into truth. As we honor Christ, the only King and Head of the Church, we pray for the continuation of Christ's ministry through the Church. We pray that you will comfort this broken world. May the vision of your peaceable kingdom take root in your church, in our families, in our community, and in our countries marked by violence and struggles for power. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Give wisdom to all leaders and people to resist the earthly powers that destroy our common life. Guide us in the way of peace. Bring unity of mission to your church and fill us with a joy for your gospel as we invite others into your reign. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We pray for our neighbors that they may see in our words and actions the kingdom of God coming near. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Enfold all who suffer in body, mind, or soul into the comfort of your healing, and enable us to extend our arms in kindness as witness to your love. Eternal God, our beginning and our end, we remember those who are dying and have died. May they know the joy of your never-ending realm of peace. We also remember those concerns shared here today. We remember those that are out hunting this morning. Please keep them safe. We remember that Isla Zimmerman had a serious fall. Let her know that your love is with her and our prayers are with her as well. We pray for Todd, who had surgery. Hopefully Todd is on the road to healing. Be with Todd during this time. We pray for Dick Krieger, who had to go back to the hospital to work out some issues with medication. He will be heading to Evergreen. Dick could use your support and love as well. And we pray that John and his tests turned out okay. Please let John know that the congregation, as well as you, love him and wish him the best. We also lift up those concerns to you that are in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Let us be in the spirit of thanksgiving, not just on one day of the year, but on each and every day. Lord, we give you thanks for the joys you have given us in our lives. We especially give you thanks for the upcoming Christmas Eve choir. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
O Holy Creator, God of love, our refuge and our strength, hear the prayers of your people and grant us the grace to be ever faithful to you. We ask this through the ascended Christ, who is both Alpha and Omega. Now hear us, Lord, as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Bye.
Service is over.
Our service in the world begins.
Amen.